Would you please rise for the posting of the colors? And let us pray. Eternal God, you gave William J. Janklow a new birth in baptism and entrusted him to us for a time that seems far too short. As we gather to give thanks for his life that we shared, help us now to release him into your mighty keeping. Bring us all to that day when we shall stand in your presence with all your saints in light eternal. Through your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. First reading for this day comes from the book of Psalms, the 139th. Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it altogether. You press upon me behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. Where can I go then from your spirit, and where might I flee from your presence? If I were to climb up to heaven, you are there, and if I make the grave my bed, you are there also. And if I would take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand hold me fast. Here ends the reading. At this time, we will hear from our governor for a welcome.
Good afternoon and welcome. Thank you for joining us this afternoon to celebrate and honor the life of Governor William J. Janklow. I want to thank those viewers who are joining us on television and appreciate the broadcast professionals who are making that possible. We gather today to honor a man who was a true public servant and a governor who served twice as long as any other in our history. Again and again, decade after decade, Bill Janklow proved that there was nothing too arduous, nothing too ambitious, nothing too audacious for South Dakota to achieve. His vision for our state and his accomplishments will have impacts far into the future. At this time, please stand as Father Webster Two Hawk, the former chairman of the Rosebud Sioux Tribe, leads us in a Lakota prayer. Please stand.
Before I say a Lakota prayer, I want to just let you know how much I enjoyed being with Bill. He worked with us on the Rosebud while I was there, and also later on, from time to time, traveling with him too. And so I just want to thank God for that privilege that I had. He was a great man, but the term that befits him the most is a friend. Wakantunga, Great Spirit God, Tungashila, Nitaokie, Bill John Janklow, Ejiapi Kihewana, Narikiha, Nit Toyoki Pichetkiaku, O Chankiwa Kantunga, O Shikilayo, Natiwahi Taokiha. Ob wochantet inza wichakue, hechel inshia trugata kia, dog shake, wankichi ankapi, tachachel, wichaulapi. Natakuota ta, yustanki hinawa kantanka, sampha lawashte, kechel oyatekiha, sampha iwash akapikte, yota makopashpe, south to gora yapiki hei, imahel. Ochankewa kantanka, wichota, tak holaku. O dahina tiwahe trak in a gule umchanke, which I asked in a Oshui Chakilayo, Lechechi, Wachike mitrak, hey. Nalakotia, Doksha Bill, Akiwan Chiankikte. When interpreted means, Bill, I'll see you again. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Now, please be seated. Now we'll enjoy an Aberdeen native peer resident, Robin Scheiber. Robin.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. From the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my
Thank you, Robin. You know, the history of a man is often, too often, limited to a recounting of his career achievements and his public deeds. Yet in the end, our true nature is often better understood by recalling those private interactions between friends. Today, four friends will share some of their memories. Larry Gabriel served in the South Dakota House of Representatives for 16 years, including six as our House Majority Leader. Following that, he served almost 7 years as South Dakota Secretary of Agriculture, first with Governor Janklow and then with Governor Rounds. Mr. Larry Gabriel.
Mary Dean, the rest of Bill Janklow's family, friends. When Russ called me and asked me to share a few memories with you all today, I was very honored and very humbled There's many that would wonder how a simple cowboy from West River could get to be such close friends with a super articulate, stronger than ever, stronger than life governor. I want to tell you the first time I went into his office. I don't remember the issue. I remember one thing. There was a prayer that was framed that hung on the wall, and it said, "God, grant me patience and give it to me right now." You know, for those of you who haven't followed state politics too closely, we had a tough primary in 94. I supported Miller. I remember the convention. I was the platform chairman. I had a meeting with Bill and some of his friends and some of my friends from the House. And I remember him saying in that meeting, "There's nobody that disagreed with me more in my last 10 years as governor than that man right there," and he pointed straight at me. I didn't know what he was talking about until I went home and looked through the scrapbook, and yes, he was right. He could remember much better than I. Then the session came, and in 4 hours, the House accomplished more one day than in my entire other 15 years of serving in the legislature. We fixed the property tax mess that he campaigned about. We rewrote state aid education. We did a host of other things. The debate lasted some 4 hours in the House alone. I realized at the end of session how we'd become friends because he walked past everybody that wanted to shake his hand, and he walked back to where I sit in the back row and gave me one of those big bear hugs. I didn't think men hugged until that day. You know, in 98, I retired from politics, and I came in for the pre-inaugural. And Mary Dean, I remember you and Bill were there, and Charlotte and I knew about everybody, so we waited till toward the end to come through and talk to you. And Bill started introducing me to people as the next Secretary of Agriculture. He had never asked me if I would serve. So I ignored him. Usually that worked, didn't it? Yeah. Well, then I came to town for some business, and I went up to see him during session, and Senator Barb Everest was in there, my good friend. And he proceeded to introduce me to her as the next Secretary of Agriculture. Well, I'd had it then. I got mad. I started cussing him, called him every name I could think of, and I told him I didn't want to be his Secretary of Agriculture. And you know what? He laughed, and he said, "Yes, you will. I know you better than you know yourself." And I guess he was right. Bill, I hope that I did at least half of the things that you asked me to do when I went to work as Secretary of Ag. It was the greatest job that I could have had because I worked for a true, true leader. You know, I'm haunted a little bit by what he told me many times when we were flying back in after a long day at Jasper Fire or wherever. And we would all tell him he needed to rest more. And he always said there's time to rest in perpetuity. Well, Bill, rest in peace. You're my friend.
Thank you, Larry. The next remembrance today is from Lars Herseth. Lars served in the legislature for 20 years, including roles as president pro tempore of the Senate and as minority leader of both the Senate and the House of Representatives. Mr. Herseth was also the 1986 Democratic nominee for governor of South Dakota. Mr. Lars Herseth.
Governor and Linda, and friends of Bill, especially Mary Dean, Russell, Pam, and Shauna, and your families, official condolences go out to you because I know For all of us, we lost a friend, sometimes a foe, and for you, it's your husband, your father, your grandfather, our uncle. I know that with all the ups and downs of a family and political life, you live all of those very fine moments and exhilarating moments, but you also get in on the other. And when you're a family of one such as Bill Janklow, who I consider my political friend, my political foe, and my political adversary, as many times, I know that the parts that we share are certainly different than the parts that you share. So from my family, from Diane and my extended family, all of our thoughts and prayers go with you. It's pretty difficult in a few short minutes to share a lot of what we think of our Governor Bill Janklow. He has touched so many of our lives. We came into politics about the same time. I came into the House of Representatives when he became Attorney General. Our paths crossed many times. And not only through my life, but then my daughter's life. And through all of that, he remained that political friend, political adversary, but always a friend. You know, we sometimes, when you put that balance beam out there and say how things are going to balance out for an individual throughout their life as they look back on it, certainly one that has served in public life. And as all of us do, we have flaws, and our Governor Bill had his share. But when that balance beam balances out, I guess I ask you, can you envision a South Dakota without railroads running from state to state, east and west, north and south? That's what we're looking at. Can you envision a South Dakota without Citibank and all of the things that it had as offshoots, including the healthcare field today, because that came really from the same industry? Can you imagine a South Dakota that wasn't or had to go through a lot to get connected with the internet world? Can you imagine a South Dakota that still had another institution of higher education at Springfield instead of a prison? All of those things, as you give them the test of time, will bear out that this visionary, this strong advocate, one who believed in his convictions, who certainly stepped on some toes at times when he was after those convictions and trying to implement them for what he perceived, and in most cases was right, as the betterment for all of us in South Dakota. He certainly believed in an activist role of government and those who manage government to play that role along with it for better business in South Dakota and better lives for all of us. You know, I look back at all of the different times our lives have crossed, and certainly at times on the same side of the fence, other times not. But I think to me one of the things that shows the testament to this man that I will first remember, it was an incident where I was not even there, but was told of it later. And it has always since kind of the first thought that crosses through my mind when I think of Bill Janklow. It was through a race that he had against my daughter, Stephanie. And of course, shortly thereafter, the mishap that befell Bill. And when those happen, they befall in the family. But ironically, as politics in South Dakota is, And seemingly, as Bill used to say, we're all one big family. That opened a window of opportunity for my daughter, as strange as that may seem, and having at one time been a political foe. So you'd think that perhaps sometimes there was some animosity there. But those of you who know Bill know that that wouldn't stand. I'm told that at a reception in Sioux Falls a couple of years ago, that both Stephanie and Bill were there. I can't remember whether it was Citibank or the Chamber, and it really doesn't matter. But Stephanie heard behind her this kind of deep voice saying, "Hey, do you suppose I can get a hug from my congresswoman?" And she turned around, and there was Bill. And Bill got his hug. And that's usually the first thought when I think of Bill Janklow that comes to my mind. Our thoughts are with you, Mary Dean, and your family. And may the best be with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Les. Now we'll hear from former Supreme Court Justice Judith Meyer Henry. Judith served in the Janklow administration as Secretary of Labor and also as Secretary of Education. After 14 years as a circuit court judge, Judith was appointed by Governor Janklow to be the first woman on South Dakota's Supreme Court. She retired just last year. Former Justice Judith Meyer Henry.
Thank you, Governor. Mary Dean, Russell, Pam, Shauna, grandchildren and friends and family, it is truly an honor for me to be asked to share my remembrances of my friend, Bill Janklow. We all know about Bill's accomplishments and the things he's done for South Dakota. They were chronicled during his lifetime and certainly have been repeated again in the last few days. But for many of us, it isn't the big things and all the chronicle of his life. It's the little things and it's the small moments that we had with him, the personal moments, the private time that we remembered these last few days, and that I want to share some of those that I can here today. You know, it was those private little conversations, personal asides. When you were in a crowd, he'd pull you aside and whisper something to you that was private and personal. And then what I remember when I think of Bill is his delightful full-body giggle when he would find something humorous. And those are the things that come to mind. Bill Janklow appeared in our lives way back in the early 1960s when we were all college students at the University of South Dakota. Mark and I were there, Bill and Mary Dean. We were a bunch of ragtag students who even then, however, believed that we could change the world and make it better. Bill and Mary Dean, Mark and I, were married students. We had children and no money. And for entertainment, we would bundle up the kids, put them in the Nash Rambler, and chase fire trucks. Remember that? We'd hear the whistle go off, and one or the other, we'd get together, and then off we'd go. And then I think even later on, Bill actually got a scanner, so he knew exactly where the fire was. And there were times when we'd beat the fire truck to the fire. We thought it was pretty exciting, but then we were probably easily entertained in those days. Also for fun, we'd pool our resources and get together and fix a meal for all of us. Or we'd gather around Bill's living room with the usual suspects, people like Bill Cerska, Rick Johnson, Judy Atkinson, to name a few, and scheme about how we could infiltrate student government at USD, which we actually did. That was my first introduction to politics, and of course that was not the end of it with Bill Janklow. The next thing I knew, he and Mark talked me into running to be the delegate to the state convention from Todd County when we lived in Mission. Then there was, the next time, Bill's on-again, off-again decision on whether or not to run for the nomination for Attorney General. And we were living, Mark and I were living in Vermilion at that time, and it was 1974, and Bill had called us and said he wanted us to come to the convention and help man the hospitality room for him. So we were all packed, ready to go, and he, of course we got the phone call, and he was running, we were all ready to go, we'll see you there. Then we got the phone call. No, he was already there, he had scoped it out, and he was absolutely sure they hated him and that he would not in any way get the nomination. So he said, don't bother to come out, I'm not gonna run. So we unpacked our clothes, stayed home, and the next morning we picked up the newspaper, and here it was, Bill Janklow, selected for the Attorney General candidate. So, you know, that was the second time. And this may be a surprise to some of you, but there were times when he was somewhat indecisive, and that was one of them. 4 years later, we were all on the campaign trail together. Bill was running for governor, and I think he was extremely instrumental in talking my husband Mark into running for Attorney General. Bill was running for governor, and then Mark would be the Attorney General. Then, so we were on the campaign trail, and lo and behold, they both won. And on December 31st, 1978, we gathered at Bill and Mary Dean's house in their living room. We had the kids were all spiffed up and shiny in their Sunday best, and all the family was around. And we proceeded to the Capitol building right here, and in the governor's conference room, watched Bill be sworn in at the stroke of midnight for the governor of South Dakota. And then Mark was sworn in shortly thereafter because it left a vacancy for Attorney General. So that brought in a new era. The excitement, you know, the rest is kind of history. The excitement of being here, of the people that he brought in that first term, was unbelievable. We were young. I mean, none of us were 40 years old. We were in our early 30s, mid-30s. Bill was 39 when he was sworn in. We were eager. We believed that we could change the world, and everybody was worked hard and did what they needed to. And Bill, there is not hardly one thing in South Dakota since then that hasn't been touched by him. My life included. I intended actually to go back to practicing law once we'd moved to Pierre, but a late night phone call from Bill, as usual late night, we were in bed asleep, changed all that. Before I had a chance to even unpack and get the family settled in, he'd convinced me that I needed to go to work for his administration. And during his first term and part of his second, I did just that. To say it was a challenge to work for Bill is somewhat of an understatement, as some of us know. There was a reason we so fondly remember or referred to him as Wild Bill. There was never a dull moment. There was never a lull for a new idea or a new project. He was absolutely relentless, and he expected the same from everybody around him. A phone call at any time of the day or night with a specific question or directive, that was his style of management. You knew when you picked up the phone and heard his voice on the other end of the line that he had some new project or some impossible idea that he wanted you to make happen. Good thing we were all young and fearless and still believed that we could make a difference and make things better. He also had an uncanny sixth sense. One time when Helen Wagner and I, who were both on his cabinet the first term around, had traveled to Sioux Falls in the morning to go to an early morning meeting, and we thought, we've been working hard. We deserve this. We're going to take a little extra time here. We're going to sneak away, have a nice, quiet lunch in some out-of-way place in Sioux Falls. Nobody knew where we were, and then we'd return back to Pier. Well, we'd sat down, and we were about halfway through the meal. The waiter comes over and says, "There's a call from the governor's office." We never did figure out how he found where we were. What is also noteworthy, actually, about that is that we were women serving on his cabinet. And this was a time in the early 1980s where women were struggling for equality in the workplace. I'd go to some national meetings and talk to other women, and they were always just disgusted because their governor or whatever was not placing women in positions of power. And that was not the case here. It didn't make much difference to Bill, and without fanfare, he put women in positions of authority all over state government. And because he knew that they were qualified and that they could get the job done. And secretly, I think he liked working with women. So dozens of women in this state, some of them in this room, today attribute their ability to get into the workforce and have a successful career to having started with Bill Janklow because he gave them that opportunity. And for personal reasons, I particularly am pleased that it was Bill Janklow that appointed the first woman to the South Dakota Supreme Court. Last spring, I called Bill to tell him that I had decided to retire, and as always, as a true friend, he supported my decision and was excited for me. We reminisced, and he reminded me of the time so long ago in Vermilion when he and Mary Dean ate homemade tacos at our house. We had the taco shells and the beef, and they brought the beans. "We have been good friends for a long time," he said, and he wished me luck. Our lives have been intertwined for a long time, and we've shared a lot of memories. We have reached now the final scene of this full and rewarding life. The camera fades, and now the credits are starting to roll and across the screen. And like a lot of long and fulfilled and wonderful stories, we are left wishing for more. But even so, we without hesitation, we stand and applaud with tears in our eyes and love in our hearts, and with a pride and celebration, because we know that one man can and did make a difference. Thank you, Bill, for being my friend.
Sorry. That was wonderful. We'll now hear from Supreme Court Justice Stephen Zinter. After working in the Attorney General's office and as Hughes County's state's attorney, Justice Zinter served for 10 years as a circuit court judge. Governor Janklow appointed Justice Zinter to the Supreme Court in 2002, where he remains. Supreme Court Justice Stephen Zinter.
Mary Dean, you guys. President Harry S. Truman said, men make history and not the other way around. In periods where there is no leadership, society stands still. Well, ladies and gentlemen, no matter what your politics, I think all South Dakotans would agree, William J. Janklow led this state for nearly a quarter of a century. And South Dakota never, ever stood still under his leadership. Last week, one of the state's newspapers, in describing Bill's passing, began its story with a gripping one-sentence metaphor. The paper said, "The lion is dead." Although I think South Dakotans agree with the description of our lion, Bill Janklow lives on. He lives on through the legacy that you've heard spoken today and that you've watched and listened to in the media this week. You know, it's especially fitting that we're in this building today, honoring him and that he's lying in state here. After all, this building just turned 100 years old, and our Bill Janklow spent 20 of those years in this place doing the people's business. Additionally, he was the principal architect and the moving force behind the renovation of this building. So as you look at this ornate paintings and the woodwork, remember now and for years that you're looking at Bill Janklow's fingerprints. As a justice of the Supreme Court, I want to focus a little bit on the legal side of Bill Janklow. I met Bill 38 years ago when I was finishing law school. During his term as Attorney General, Bill made a point of hiring young law students, and I was one of the few and fortunate that were chosen by him to work for him. And you know, he was a mentor to all of us. He pushed us hard, working for Bill Janklow was not easy. He pushed us hard to be good lawyers, but more importantly, he pushed us to be good citizens. As I watched him over the years, there's one thing that was certain about his legal career. He loved being a lawyer. He was a quick study, a fierce litigator. I can tell you from personal experience that no judge or lawyer wanted to be on the other side. And if they were, they were prepared when they knew Bill Janklow was coming to court. He personally argued and won 3 cases in the United States Supreme Court. He was either one of the parties in, or he was the senior lawyer on 297 cases that got to the South Dakota Supreme Court. That's not to count another 107 cases that he fulfilled that role in the federal and district courts and circuit courts of the state of South Dakota. What did I see about him as a public political figure? Much has been written in these last days, but I think it confirms a few things. First, he was an iconic attorney general and governor. And you know, the Democrat-Republican label meant little to him. He was a populist and a visionary. We have not seen anything like it, in my opinion, since Governor Peter Norbeck. In my view, his accomplishments will go down in recorded history as the best. I'm not going to go through those accomplishments. You've heard about them. I think what's more important is that his motivation for those accomplishments was never concern about himself or self-interest. The real Bill Janklow was motivated by loyalty to friends, family, and country. It was also motivated by a big, huge, soft heart. People don't know that, that never got next to him. But when you got next to him, you saw that. This last week, and for years actually, people have struggled with reconciling the different Bill Janklows. I think my wife put her finger on it this week when she told me two derivations of one word that explain the conflict: passion and compassion. Passion for friends and family, passion for the public good, passion for this state and its people, and notably, passion for problem solving and getting things done. But at the same time, he had compassion for the poor, the disadvantaged, those in need, and the oppressed. Let me end with two things. The first and the most important, which you have not heard enough about these last days, and that's you, Mary Dean. Any observer of Bill Janklow knows that he worked incessantly on the state's business. That meant day and night in this building and in the Janklow home. You know, that home, my favorite part was that chair, that overstuffed chair. If you went into that home, you didn't touch anything around that chair, but it was piled this high, all the way around, with books, magazines, reports, everything you can think of that he devoured. And he, of course, he was always reorganizing it, but I don't think he ever got it done. But in that home, Mary Dean ran that home. And so I think it's time that we say thank you, Mary Dean, for a number of things. Thank you for being our First Lady. Thank you for sacrificing your cherished privacy. Thank you for letting so many of us invade your home. Thank you for raising three beautiful children, Russell, Pam, and Shauna. And thank you for letting so many of us be a part of your family. But most of all, Mary Dean, thank you for sharing Bill with the people of the state of South Dakota. We all know that families are partnerships. And you, in your quiet way, were the partner that enabled Bill to do what he did for the people of this state. The final thing I'm going to say will make Bill, and many of you that know him, chuckle. I say that because I'm going to quote something favorable about him from All Things a Newspaper. In a 1980 profile, the New York Times described Bill as, quote, intelligent, intense, and articulate with the energy of a brigade of ordinary mortals. Well, that description of Bill Janklow never changed, except I think in passing, history will cause a reassessment about ordinary mortality. A famous 16th century poet, in discussing death and immortality, said about death and immortality, death comes to all, but great achievements leave a monument which shall endure until the sun grows old. William J. Janklow, his accomplishments and what he left behind are chiseled deep into South Dakota's granite. They live on as a monument that will endure until the sun grows old.
We have a few minutes. I know some of you are wondering what I'm doing up here. Our relationship with the governor goes back to 1996. And I know the governor was rightfully proud of having worked in front of the Supreme Court three times and having won all three arguments. And in 1996, the governor and I had an argument. And I wrote him an email. Took three drafts. Thank God for wives who can temper one's passions and emails. I did not expect the governor to read it or to hear a response, and as I returned the day after from Highmore for a funeral, I received a phone call from the governor's office. Would I please come and meet with the governor? I really did not want to do that. I arrived back in town and I called the governor's office and I said I would be over, and they said, well, the governor's in a meeting, and let wait one, and 10 seconds later, I was told, yes, you want to come right now. So I was escorted into the governor's office. There were five individuals in the office. I had no idea who they are. And the governor stood up and he said, Pastor, I need to apologize. And I wanted to go, I'll be right back. I need to write that down. And that began the friendship. Wow, to have the governor of South Dakota, one, read your email, second, respond, and third, to apologize. So I know he was proud of having won his arguments in front of the Supreme Court, but man, I'm telling you, I wrote that baby down in my planner. And when I'm buried, that page is going in the, it's going with me. We had a remarkable relationship. I learned early on that he had a great capacity to preach. We regularly did funerals together, and there was no way you could get around him. It didn't matter if he went first or second. He was going to steal your sermon, and that's the way it was. I have the privilege of preaching tomorrow. I was invited by Bill to be his pastor over these last months. It has been a privilege. I want to speak on behalf of the family. They have been a joy to work with, a remarkable family to work with. I've been a parish pastor for 31 years. I have worked with hundreds of families as they have said and ministered to a loved one who is dying. And I can tell you that this family just did marvelous work. From Mary Dean to the children, to brothers, to a mother, who I tell you, if you want to know where the energy and the intellect comes from, holy mackerel, don't ever get in front of her. It would just be a speed bump and not very big. But they have been a gift to their husband, to their father, to their brother. You just did marvelous work as you ministered and took care of Bill. It was a privilege to be with you. Let me say just a brief thank you to the governor and to the first lady, to the employees of state government. They have been a joy to work with. They have been so compassionate over these last 2 weeks. They have gone out of their way to be of service to this family and to the people of South Dakota. I can't say enough about our governor and those that work for him here today about their gift to this family and to this state. So, finally, to the people of South Dakota that I know are watching, thousands of letters have come into the Janklow family, to Governor Janklow. To the best of his ability, he read every one. I know that he has worked diligently over these past months to mend relationships, to renew relationships, to work at saying goodbye. He did the work that I think people need to do when we know that our time is coming. he was a privilege to serve alongside of and to be his pastor. So blessings to you as the family, to Mary Dean, the kids, brothers, blessings to this people of the state of South Dakota. At this time, I'm going to ask that you remain seated, and we invite the extended family to take their place on the steps of the Capitol. Would everyone else please remain seated at this time? We need the extended family to move, if the immediate family would stay right here. And now would you please rise for the retiring of the colors. Would you please remain in place while the immediate family is escorted to the steps of the Capitol?